Vítejte u, aby bylo jasno. Proč v rusko-ukrajinském konfliktu ztratí nejen Rusko, ale také NATO? V jakém stavu je ukrajinská ekonomika a co může dělat OSN pro ukončení konfliktu? Může za růst cen ve Spojených státech a v Evropě skutečně Putin, jak tvrdí někteří politici? A co je v současné krizové době hlavním úkolem ekonomů? I o tom dnes budeme hovořit. Vzácným hostem pořadu, aby bylo jasno, je americký ekonom a profesor Kolumbijské univerzity, který se podílel na polské ekonomické transformaci. S návratem k tržní ekonomice radil také slovinské a estonské vládě a především ruským prezidentům Michailu Gorbačovovi a Borisu Jelcinovi. Dnes působí jako poradce šéfa Organizace spojených národů a je označován za jednoho z nejvlivnějších světových ekonomů. K České republice má blízko díky své české manželce, lékařce Sonie. Profesor Jeffrey Sachs. Pane profesore, děkujeme, že jste přijal naše pozvání. Invaze Vladimíra Putina na Ukrajinu se zvrhla v horkou válku v duchu tradice, že každá strana věří, že vyhraje, ale ve skutečnosti obě strany prohrají. To jsou vaše nedávná slova. Proč si to myslíte?
Terrible situation that is very dangerous. Lots of people getting killed, of course, tremendous destruction. But there seems to be a big misunderstanding because both sides proclaim, well, we're winning. We don't really know exactly the situation, but I would say that Ukraine is certainly losing. It's losing people, it's losing sovereignty. It is facing mass destruction. And from what we can see on the battlefield, Russia is taking more territory in Lugansk and Donetsk. It has captured a lot of territory on the coast of the Black Sea and established that land bridge, much talked about, with Crimea. I frankly don't believe the Ukrainian claim that they will push Russia out militarily and force Russia to abandon all of its territorial gains on the battlefield. It seems completely unrealistic to me. And moreover, extraordinarily dangerous for Ukraine because it means a lot more fighting. And of course, the Ukrainian economy is probably in a state of full collapse. We don't know completely, but the export sector is destroyed. The metallurgy sector is destroyed. The crop harvest is down between a third and a half. So this is a terrible situation, but so far still with lots of strong talk. The more that goes on, the stranger the situation, because I think it's more likely than not that Russia gains more territory, that the deaths and destruction seem sure to continue. The crisis in Europe is very bad, more generally, not like in Ukraine, but it's still, this is a sharp economic crisis. And that's true worldwide. So I don't see any end game other than getting back to the negotiating table. And that's why I keep saying that the US gave bad advice, don't negotiate. The US failed to discuss with Putin real issues, the most important of which was NATO enlargement to Ukraine, which if I were a Russian leader, I would also oppose. So that needed to be discussed at least. And Biden said, no, we don't discuss it. So to me, it doesn't add up what's happening right now to any kind of sound strategy. It just seems to me to be misguided and dangerous.
A jak konflikt ovlivní rozvojové země, které jsou závislé na dovozu potravin a energií?
The whole world economy is suffering from this, especially food-dependent poor countries. I was in Egypt recently, which buys a tremendous amount of grain from Ukraine. Bread prices have soared, but that's the staple food. And that's true in many countries in Africa, which are grain importing countries. It's true of poor people everywhere. It's also true in Europe and the United States that while it's not as desperate as in poor countries, prices have risen sharply, and this is creating a lot of distress. It's also creating a deep political crisis for many governments, including in the United States, because Biden's popularity continues to fall. Excuse me. It reached the lowest levels just now, 36% approval. I don't approve of his performance. I think that he missed the chances for a peaceful outcome of this. And so, but I am basing that on policies. Many people in the United States just see prices going up and they don't like it. And that's true of a lot of governments. That's going to be true in Europe as well. We need a better strategy than just declarations of defeating Putin. That's not a strategy. It's not very realistic. By the way, not to mention, if it were realistic that Putin would be defeated by the American armaments, I'm quite sure that he would escalate. And if he were still pushed to a corner, the chance of using nuclear weapons in Ukraine would be very real. So even the idea of defeating a nuclear superpower this way strikes me as a very weird, strange idea. Is anybody thinking in my government in the US? I'm not so sure. I'm not so sure anybody's really thinking very hard.
Pane profesore, my víme, že jste poradcem pana Guterrese, generálního tajemníka Organizace spojených národů. Řekněte, má OSN možnost a sílu nějak řešit konflikt mezi Ukrajinou a Ruskem?
First, let me say that I'm an advisor on the Sustainable Development Goals and on the economy, not on the military or security issues. So I just want to be clear about that. But the UN was established to keep the peace and to return to peace. So I believe that it is the assignment of the UN Charter, especially to the UN Security Council, to meet, deliberate, and solve this problem. Now, many people say, especially in the United States, oh, that's ridiculous. Putin is a member of the Security Council. My answer is yes, precisely. This is why we need discussion, because we have it in our heads, and it's a bad idea. It relates actually to the Czech Republic in history, of course. We have it in our heads. We shouldn't even discuss with Russia. The diplomats don't even meet. And you know, everything always refers back to Munich, 1938. Chamberlain met with Hitler and, of course, conceded the Sudetenland, northern Bohemia, to Hitler. And what the lesson that was taken from that is don't talk, because that's appeasement. To my mind, this is not the right lesson at all. Of course, one needs to be accurate in any negotiations. One needs not to accept what Putin says straight out. Of course not. One doesn't need to say, oh, you say it, therefore we agree. But you need to negotiate and you need to discuss. And the idea, by the way, that the situation today is the same as 1938 is also wrong. Mm-hmm. Each history has its own specifics, yeah. And each history needs to be looked at more seriously, not just a slogan to say, well, look at Munich, therefore we don't talk. Because the situation here is more complicated. The situation here really does involve a lot of U.S. intervention in the Black Sea region over the years that were provocative. Why, for example, did the United States push for NATO to expand to Georgia as well as Ukraine already back in 2008? The Russians were horrified at that idea. NATO's supposed to be a defensive alliance. Why is it moving ever eastward, already into the Black Sea with Bulgaria, Romania, and then invitation to Ukraine and invitation to Georgia, for heaven's sake? Well, I think Russia's answer was, you're trying to encircle us in the Black Sea. And if you look at a map, you can understand Russia's attitude. And if you think back to long history, like the Crimean War, back from 1853 to 1856, the West came in to try to kick Russia out of the Black Sea. It took over Sevastopol. Well, there are long memories of this. So we should not be so provocative. We should be trying to find a modus vivendi, not trying to continue to enlarge the military alliance. This is my problem, that we didn't even try constructively to find real solutions.
Mohu se také zeptat na inflaci? Ve Spojených státech i v mnoha evropských zemích, včetně naší České republice, prudce rostou ceny. Mnoho politiků, včetně například i amerického prezidenta Bidena, to dává do souvislosti s válkou a o prudkém zdražování hovoří jako o Putinově inflaci. Co si o tomhle myslíte?
I came into economics as a scholar 41 years ago, 42 years ago, working on the problem of stagflation. Because in the 1970s, we also had the situation not unlike today. Oil prices were soaring, and there was high inflation, there was an economic downturn, and there were a lot of similarities because we find that the underlying causes are several. Definitely the war is part of this, but so is geopolitics. The U.S. sanctions amplified the direct effects of the war, definitely. And Europe, by saying, well, we won't buy Russian oil or we won't buy Russian gas, further raised the price. But then on top of that, we had the pandemic, which was also destabilizing because it disrupted global supply chains. On top of that, we have the U.S. trade war with China, because the U.S. is hostile to China. And by the way, that trade war was not started by China, was started by the United States, because the U.S. is afraid of China. I'm not afraid of China. I go to China all the time. But the U.S. is afraid that China's too successful. I find this a kind of psychoanalytic neurosis, I would say, more than an economic phenomenon, because the U.S. doesn't like to have rival countries. But China has become successful and a kind of rival. And so the U.S. is very worried. But the point is that the U.S. is cutting all sorts of trade relations with China, and that also exacerbates the inflation. The U.S. put on tariffs on Chinese goods, but it also did stop a lot of Chinese production, for example, of low-cost electronics by creating a boycott on the export from all the world of higher-end semiconductors. But then on top of all of this is the monetary policy of the last 10 years. And this is like the 1970s also. The Federal Reserve was incredibly expansionary in monetary policy. In fact, unprecedented amount of money creation after 2008 all the way till just recently. The money supply, what we call high-powered money, which is the central bank's money, went up about 6 times. This is extraordinary. If you were in an economics class, you would say, that's crazy. That's for a homework assignment. That's not for the real world. But the Fed created so much money. And for a long time, it didn't raise prices very much. And they said, oh, we can continue to print money, buy the debt of our government, and nothing's happening. What was happening was that asset prices were rising. So the money was being used to buy Bitcoin, for example. Why should something worthless like Bitcoin have such a high market price? Well, because so much money was being printed by the Fed. Also, the stock market rose sharply because people took the liquidity and bought stocks with it. But now that money is finding its way into the real economy. First in general commodities, and now more generally in everything. So the inflation is pretty broad-based. So to answer your question, the inflation comes from many things. It comes from the war. It comes from the sanctions. It comes from the COVID. It comes from the U.S. Trade war on China. And it comes from the central bank policies of the Fed, the European Central Bank, other central banks that were very expansionary in monetary policy and thought that they were doing it without risk of inflation, but it turned out to have long-term inflationary consequences. We had, of course, a monetarist economist in earlier decades, he's no longer alive, Milton Friedman, who used to say that the effect of money increase was with long and variable lags. In other words, you increase the money supply, it doesn't immediately turn into prices, but it does with long and variable lags. And I think that that's true. So it's just like when I wrote my dissertation, incredibly, 42 years ago. It's all these factors, and I published a book exactly 40 years ago called The Economics of Worldwide Stagflation, which discussed all of these factors. And now I should come out with the second edition, I think.
Pane profesore, teď se hodně mluví o tom, že během jediného desetiletí zažije svět už druhou globální recesi. A v minulosti každá velká krize vždycky vedla k nějakému novému ekonomickému myšlení, k nové ekonomické škole. Na velkou depresi reagovala světová ekonomie keynesiánstvím, na stagflaci, o které jste mluvil, monetarismem a tak dále. Vy sám jste profesor ekonomie. Vidíte dnes po velké recesi z roku 2007, po covidové krizi a ve světle dnešní současné ukrajinsko-ruské krize nějaký zárodek nové ekonomické školy, nového ekonomického myšlení?
First, this crisis could still turn into a bigger and bigger disaster. So we need to solve some basic problems urgently, starting with ending the war. Because as long as the war goes on, many more crises can come that can be very, very dangerous. So it's hard to predict anything right now, but we should take clear actions to stop things from getting out of hand. We can be sure that there are some underlying deep crises that need to be addressed even after the war is over and even after this pandemic is controlled, because we have an ecological crisis that's very serious. We have a geopolitical change in the world with the U.S. losing its dominance, and with the rise of China, and now with so much more of a divided world. And we have the ongoing technological changes, especially digitalization, artificial intelligence, robotics. This is changing a lot in the economy. So what we can be sure of is that there will be a lot more disruption, a lot more inequality, a lot more uncertainty, a lot more political stress. I recommend that to get out of this, we also need a lot more cooperation globally. Because if each country, each society is facing these stresses on their own, the tensions are going to be extremely high. Whereas if we actually cooperate, for example, to solve the energy transformation, or to ensure that the digital world is satisfactory for us and not a new divide, and to stop the rising tensions between the US, Russia, China, you know, that are breaking the world apart, we could actually go back to what we thought we were doing, which was investing in a better future. We seem to have lost the track that we actually want to make something better, not just stop disaster, but make something better. So I use the phrase sustainable development. That's the title of my professorship. That is the title of the UN network that I lead, the UN Sustainable Development Solutions Network. It's my belief that we need a new philosophy in which we are aiming to combine economic, social justice, and environmental objectives together, that we are aiming for regional and global cooperation, and that we are not wasting our time and lives on war and on conflicts between systems, so-called. You know, Biden always talks about that we're in some great struggle between democracy and autocracy. I think this is such a wrong way to think about the world. Maybe it's the way that a 79-year-old person brought up on the Cold War thinks about the world. But young people don't want to think about the world as a struggle that divides the world. They want to find out, how do I have a normal life in the future without conflict and without environmental destruction? And we shouldn't phrase our challenge as some great struggle of systems. I wish Biden once would give a speech about global cooperation. Why doesn't he give a speech that says, I want to cooperate with China, not just oppose China? But he doesn't. So this is why I favor sustainable development as a better approach. It's cooperative. We're all in the same situation together. We have similar things to do, but if we're working together, we'll actually get them done.
Vy sám také učíte, zmínil jste teď mladé lidi. Co by podle vás měla v dnešním krizovém světě dělat ekonomie? Co je cílem ekonomů, zejména těch mladých? Co bychom měli v této situaci právě teď dělat?
First of all, economics should have a purpose, which is to make a better life for people. We don't say that medical school is just to study disease. We say that medical school is to help make people healthier. So economics should be to make people better off, happier, more fulfilling life. And by the way, that doesn't just mean higher gross domestic product. It can mean more leisure time, more culture, more study time, more tourism, exchange of ideas. In other words, we want higher well-being. So that's the first point. We want an economics of well-being. And by the way, this is how the study of politics got started, by Plato and Aristotle in ancient Greece. They didn't say, we just study. When Aristotle wrote the book, The Politics, which includes a good discussion of economics too, he didn't say this is just to understand, this is to make for well-being. And this is our starting point. Second, then we need our students to understand the real challenges in the world today. So our students should understand that how the world is divided between rich and poor. They should understand the ecological challenges. They should understand how technology is changing and requiring different kinds of jobs and different kinds of education for the future. And they should understand the ways that our national and our international systems, whether it's markets or government processes or civil society, have their respective roles to play in helping to achieve this betterment. This is not exactly how we teach economics right now. We tend to teach economics, both your job is to study markets, understand them, run statistical equations, maybe make some predictions. But if you have ideas about what would be better, leave them to yourself. That's not the job. You know, you're to be an economic scientist. But this is like saying to a doctor, you know, if you want to treat people, that's your own business. You should just study disease. This is a wrong idea. So we need to revise how we're teaching economics. I'm writing a new textbook now on this basis, Macroeconomics for the Good, Macroeconomics for Sustainable Development, that really aims at creating new instruments and tools to achieve what we want to achieve. And we have responsibilities. Even the issue of, you know, climate change, it's not very well understood. I know in the Czech Republic and actually almost any place where people produce coal or oil, oh, we don't want to hear about that sometimes. But, you know, it's a very serious, real issue. And there are good solutions to it. And our students should study those, understand them, help to say, okay, here's what the Czech Republic could do on energy transformation. Here's what the European Union should do on its European Green Deal and so forth, to really get involved in problem solving. I called it clinical economics when I studied this in the past, and that's how I've tried to be an economist, because my wife's a doctor, she's a clinician. Mm-hmm. She actually treats patients and makes them better. I was very jealous. I thought, gee, if only economists could do that. But the skills that you need for that approach are somewhat different from what we teach. Because if you're a clinician, you look at the patient and say, how do I help make you better? And you really have in economics, that would mean a policy orientation, but you have to know a lot of specifics about your patient too.
Pane profesore, děkujeme za zajímavý rozhovor i za váš čas. Naschledanou.